those of you who perhaps visited before will know this is the time of day when we get to learn a little bit more about our lovely penguins, and hopefully if they're hungry, also watch them have their afternoon snack. Now I do warn you, sometimes the warm weather can make them a little bit lethargic. They kind of be like, oh, it's too hot for anything to eat. Yesterday they did leave me hanging horribly, none of them came down to the beach, but hopefully today things will be a bit different, they're looking a bit keener. Good news, nicely done there, very elegant and graceful. So before I do talk about the African penguins, I'm briefly going to mention a few of the two species that we have here in this exhibit. They are worthy of our attention as well, I think. So flying around above your heads, you should hopefully be getting a nice view of our Inca terns now. These are the little sooty black birds whizzing about with the nice jazzy orange feet and their little carrot bill there as well. So these are all members of the gull family, like the terns that you get around the coast of the British Isles. Although the birds that we have around our shores are predominantly white in colour, normally with black markings around the head area. So where do Inca terns come from? Well, they do come from somewhere very different, all the way from South America, countries like Peru and Chile. So quite an exotic bird really, and I certainly think they look as exotic as their sort of native countries. Now, at the moment the terns are breeding for us, which is really good. We've got several chicks and also several pairs still on eggs awaiting hatching, which is really good news. And last year we actually managed to rear 10 Inca terns in total, so we're hoping to overbeat that or at least replicate it this time round. So at this time of year they're a bit more vociferous than they normally are, particularly I'm afraid I'm sort of persona non grata in the penguin enclosure at the moment. If I dare to walk along the public walkway, I get dive bombed, I pet the back of my head, they poo on me deliberately, and pretty much with an airing accuracy actually. They did get me in the ear this morning, which was a bit distressing, but that's all part of their natural behaviours. They normally poo on predators, usually predatory birds, because this soils the feathers and impairs their ability to fly. So it's actually a really clever way of deterring things that might actually attack their eggs or their chicks. So it's a bit unpleasant for me, but you can sort of understand it really when you think about it like that. So if you're looking at them, you'll see that mixed in there are some brownish birds, and these aren't females as you might think. These are actually last year's babies that are just colouring up now, and it takes them about a year to develop their full adult plumage. So to human eyes, there isn't actually any difference between male and female Inca terns. Presumably the terns know, otherwise things could get quite tricky from the breeding season. And probably they can tell this from things like body language, but also probably the tone and the pitch of the calls that they make is different for males and females. Much as it is with humans really, you know, it's fairly easy to tell. So all these things they're using to find a partner. And you'll see them together actually making this kind of quite raucous chattering noise. You'll also see them hanging about with their bits of fish in their bill, and what they're actually doing is they're waiting for me to get out of the way so that they can go and feed their babies. We do have one actually in the tunnel underneath the walkway there, so mum and dad are sort of waiting, just saying like, come on mum, hurry up, we're going to take this bit of fish in. So they're all busy just now being concerned. Over to my right hand side, I think I last saw them, are common eider ducks. Now these are quite a special bird here at Bristol Zoo, not least because they are one of my favourites. I think they're very handsome. We did have a lady in the enclosure the other day that I overheard describing them as designer ducks, and I think that's kind of true. They do look quite posh really for a duck, don't they? But the eider duck is actually a bird that you can see here in the UK in the wild, so they're one of the native species that we hold in this collection. You'll see the male is a really lovely black and white checkerboard with a splodge of sea green on the nape of his neck. We've only got one female out on the pool at the moment, reason being the other two are actually sitting on eggs, which is really great news. Hopefully, fingers crossed everybody, that we might get some baby eider ducks this year. That would be fantastic. Now, at this time of year, their wild counterparts are all the way up in the Arctic. This is where they breed. So these are birds in the northern hemisphere, unlike the penguins and the Inca terns, which both live in the south. Now, the best time to see the eider ducks in the wild of Britain is actually during winter. Hold it, unless. What happens is, during the summer months, they're up in the Arctic breeding, but once winter sets in and it starts to really cool down, that's when they come down to the shores of Northern Europe and also the UK to the relative, and I say relative, warmth that they find there. So winter is the best time to see them, usually around Scotland, actually. I thought, there we go, there's a male swimming out over here now for the scraps. Yum, yum, yum. And actually one of the things that I like best about the eider, and he's doing it just now, is their call, and it's not a quack or a honk as you might kind of expect. It's quite cheeky, it's a bit of a saucy sound, they kind of make this oh kind of noise, and It's a bit unexpected actually when you're walking along the beach and you suddenly start hearing a sort of chorus of, oh, it's an unusual noise, shall we say. And in the wild, they eat sprats here at the zoo, but in the wild they'll be feeding on pretty much anything they can get hold of, crustaceans, small fish. Their favourite food, believe it or not, is mussels. And what they do is they crunch open the shell with that big strong bill you can see and get at all the juicy tasty bits inside. And they feed by diving down. They can actually dive all the way down to the bottom of this enclosure, no problem. They kind of fly along with the water, almost like the penguins really. And if any of you are secret bird geeks out there, I'm a bit of a self-confessed bird nerd, I'm afraid, but for the old pub quiz, I do have a bit of an idea of factoid for you. In level flight, so flying along on the horizontal, they are, believe it or not, faster than a peregrine falcon. How about that? So the eidu duck, very impressive duck, so I think you'll agree. Now the African penguins, the African penguins, as the name suggests, do indeed come from Africa. And I know that for some visitors out there, there'll be a bit of a scratching of the head thinking, oh, Africa, it's a bit hot for the old penguins, isn't it? And well, really don't, because we've got this slight misconception of penguins as being sort of polar birds, really, and that's only true to a certain extent. We're lucky enough to have 17 species of penguin in the world, and they're gold star, so anybody who can name them all comes up. No, nobody. All 17. So these 17 species all live in the southern hemisphere, all below the equator, but actually only two of them really spend their lives right down in Antarctica, and that, for any penguin geeks, is the king and the emperor penguin, the two largest species. Gentoo penguins also spending quite a lot of time down there. They're really cool. They're actually the fastest penguin in the world, swimming at speeds in excess of 60 kilometres an hour, so pretty impressive stuff. But everybody else is distributed throughout the southern hemisphere, sometimes in unexpected places. Penguins can creep up on you when you're on holiday. You might not expect to see them, but there they are, sneaky wee things. You can find them in South America, several species down there, including the melanistic penguin and of course the infamous Galapagos penguin. They're a bit of an island specialist. And moving over, you do get them as well in Australia and New Zealand. And in fact, there's a species nesting in that region in Australia, but actually nesting in the forest, which is pretty cool. And the adult birds will bury it there, where they sort of dig out a little tunnel, they lay their eggs in there, they nest there. And they use freshwater rivers as highways between the sea and their nesting site. So penguins are pretty versatile looking birds, actually. You find them in some surprising places. Also, of course, the fairy or looking blue penguin out there in Australia and New Zealand, which is only 30 centimetres tall, so very dinky and very sweet. But this species here, the African or jackass, or indeed black-footed penguin, is the only species of penguin that we find in Africa. And if you picture the continent of Africa in your mind, these guys live around the pointy bit at the bottom. They sort of inhabit South Africa primarily, but colonies stretching all the way up to Namibia and also on the other side into the Indian Ocean there as well. Now, here at the zoo, I'm lucky enough to look after 57 African penguins, plus a couple of chicks at the moment, so we're hoping that they'll make it to fledging age. It'd be great if they did. So 57 African penguins, which is quite a handful. They're quite feisty little birds. They are nice to work with because they've got quite a lot of panache, I think, quite full of character, so that's great. And they do breed for us all year round. You'll see these funny little bomb shelters around the enclosure, and those are actually their nesting tunnels, similar to the Inca terns, which also have a kind of tunnelled entrance. They like to kind of keep out of the sun, really, so that's part of their behaviour when they're nesting on the beaches in Africa. They prefer to have a little tunnel if they can, just so that they've got a little bit of shade, because despite the fact that obviously Africa is very hot, the waters surrounding South Africa are in fact really cold, and there's currents coming up from the great southern ocean around Antarctica, which is seriously cold water, so they're still very well insulated, which means of course they do get a bit hot under the collar when they're up on the beaches. So in the wild, well, we've probably got about 70,000 pairs of African penguins left, and I appreciate that that does sound like a lot of penguins. That sounds like plenty of penguins, more penguins than I would know what to do with, certainly. But it's an unfortunate thing. The African penguin really is on the brink now. They are facing extinction. Their numbers have declined by over 90% in the last 100 years, and realistically they're going to be gone in 10 years' time, so well within all of our lifetimes. And I know you find that really hard to believe. You see them here, they're cute. Oh, how could it happen? 70,000 odd pairs left in the wild, but their numbers are, they're just vanishing really, really quickly. And unfortunately, it looks like we might be fighting a bit of a losing battle with them, which is not good news at all. And the primary reason really for that is actually overfishing. The reduction of fish stocks in our oceans is having a massive impact on these birds. There just isn't enough food for themselves and their offspring, and the population, basically the output, the breeding success each year is getting lower and lower. And this is meaning that there's this massive overall decline. So I really can't kind of overstress how serious the situation is. A colleague of mine has just got back from South Africa doing some work with the penguins out there in a place called Robben Island. She visited South Africa 8 years ago, and she got back just the day before yesterday, and she tells me that the difference in the number of birds that she's seen from the first time she went 8 years ago to this time is absolutely staggering. She said she was really, really shocked at how few birds are actually growing in comparison. So that puts it in a bit of a kind of perspective for us, which is very, very sad news. And I find this quite difficult to believe as well, because penguins are really popular birds, they're really popular species. If I sort of say, oh, I'm a penguin keeper, it tends to get a really good reception. People are very fond of them, but if an animal like this is facing extinction, I think that's pretty bad news really for everybody else, perhaps the less glamorous animals and plants out there that are in a similar situation. So what is Bristol Zoo doing about this one? The good news is that just by visiting us here today, you've actually already helped conserve the African penguin in the wild. Bristol Zoo supports a charity called SANCOB out in South Africa, and SANCOB are interested in the preservation of coastal seabirds. This is what they do, and it's not just penguins, they're all sorts of other bits of rods, they gannets, cormorants of various species. They did have a black-barred albatross in recently, which is a very rare bird that's also endangered and quite an unusual bird for them to get into the rehabilitation centre. And so SANCOB are engaged in several different activities to try and help boost the number of